And just looking in, we see this latex becoming more plastic. We hear it crinkling. I'm Sophie St. George. I work here at the Green Bank Observatory as an education specialist. And part of my job is working with student groups during our summer camps as well as statewide outreach. I'm going to demonstrate the importance of radio frequency interference and protecting our telescopes from that interference that we cause every day in our own lives with cell phones and key fobs. The first of which includes this Faraday cage, which is a pretty rudimentary version of a Faraday cage, and its purpose is to protect the antenna that's inside. So how a Faraday cage works is this copper mesh is reflective to radio waves, and their waves cannot get through this mesh, so they bounce off and are reflected. And right now, we can see with the door ajar, already showing in our spectrum analyzer, kind of low down here. As we open the door, you'll see that signal getting brighter. This antenna is able to pick up radio waves, and so it's able to see parts of the electromagnetic spectrum that we cannot. With that door shut, we see the signal. It may still be a little bit of a bump, but ultimately it goes away. We use this kind of technology, Faraday cages on site, to protect our radio telescopes from radio frequency interference. We used to sell these fans in the gift shop, but we don't anymore. So lots of different point sources or interferences at specific frequencies. We can see these as sharp lines raising up from that baseline. As we move the fan outside the box, further away from the antenna and also protected by this copper mesh, we see those peaks still, but they're significantly reduced. Another thing that we have to manage at the observatory are our receivers. They are electronic devices, which we've just seen produce radio frequency interference. And so we have to cool these down cryogenically, and we use compressed helium to do so. And I'm going to demonstrate a little bit of how that works to make a less noisy system. I don't have compressed helium with me, but I do have liquid nitrogen, which is very cold at -321 degrees Fahrenheit. We're going to start here by taking a very energetic system, like this balloon that I've blown up. I've put molecules in there, and they're in their gas state. So they're bouncing off the walls. They're making this balloon look expanded, look blown up. And we're going to see what happens when we cool those molecules down. So you can see that liquid nitrogen pouring out. And when we take, again, this energetic system in the balloon and pop it in there, think about what you might see happening. And just looking in, we see this latex becoming more plastic in appearance. We hear it crinkling. And we also see our balloon constricting. And when we pull it out, we'll see just exactly what's happened. Those molecules that were gas are now liquid. You can see that sort of cloudy white. We'll just let that sort of expand again. It's not reinflating, but those molecules that went from very energetic, very noisy in that gas phase, which they're returning to, were much more quiet, less energetic. And so we use this concept to cool these receivers down that have electronic components and create less noisy systems so that we don't see a whole lot of fuzzy interference from our own technology, and we can really capture the signal that's coming from space. Pretty cool.
Let us know what your favorite part of this video was in the comments section. And if you enjoyed it, be sure to give it a like and a share. Also, you can follow STEM in 30 on Facebook and Twitter, and be sure to subscribe to the National Air and Space Museum's YouTube channel.